its operations and supply chain practices, it basically should do three things. One of which, based on the discussion we had already, you guys, you already pointed out, is the early. From the builders. This is called the point of sale data, right? So it has its genesis in retailing when people were facing a lot of forecasting errors. They were able to manage their demand forecasting better when they got early point of sale data and use that in the forecasting model. In our case, the builders are the customers. So you obtain early building plans from the green builders. By that you're able to manage your demand forecasting for wood, one of the components which go into the building, okay? And then building a truss plant, which is the exterior, the top part of the building, helps the builder quote, helps in this because a truss, which is the first part of the building which is being made, the builder will give you a quote at least 60 days in advance. So this is a unique context where the customer is forced to give you early information. Okay? So if you want to do a building, you have to build a truss. And it takes that long for you to build a truss. So you go ahead and give a quote. Okay? And you can also coordinate with your upstream suppliers and make sure that you have the wood there in time. Okay? The second thing, which we got from looking at this mixed model setup and all that, is to understand the mill rotation schedule. Okay? So, because they can process FSC wood and other wood as well, and you know the process for cutting FSC wood, they have to close it down and clean up and then ship to FSC wood. When do they shut down? Because they have to shut down not only to switch over to FSC for preventive maintenance, all these other things, they have to shut down, right? So an awareness of that schedule is very important for you as well. So that way you can also coordinate for the same reasons. You can coordinate with the upstream supplier to say that, supposing you get the wood from the forest, the upstream supplier, and then the mill says, I'm on holiday over there. So that could create a problem, right? So you would know, you can coordinate that. So it gives you visibility into the lead time, and you can, optimize your inventory and also give competitive bids. Okay, there's an important principle in operations called the bullwhip effect. So the bullwhip effect basically says, in our example over here, because the upstream does not have any visibility of the downstream, there is information distortion going on. So in our example, if you take the green builder and they say that, okay, a demand for a certain truss is X units, then by the time it goes to HLC and to the mills and then to the forestry, that information gets distorted, as a result of which there is excess inventory across the supply chain, there is poor forecasting decisions made and so on. Long story short, the way to manage the bullwhip effect is to increase the transparency and visibility. So if the forestry private farms of FSC knows what the green builders need, or if the sawmills know what the green builders need, then that's much more harmonious supply chain, okay? So this visibility into lead time is a very important information. The third thing they should do, so point of sale information, understand rotation schedule, and the third thing that they should do has to do with supplier relationship. Remember yesterday we talked about supplier relationship. We are coming back to that issue over here. As it stands, HLC has no clout on anybody, right? It has no clout on the sawmills, it has no clout on the green builders. So this is a very good example that if you're stuck in a supply chain and you don't have any clout on an upstream or a downstream member, what can you do? What you can do is to build power, flexible power, okay? So how do I do that? So first thing is that you have close partnerships so that you can get just-in-time FSC lumber for HLC and their customers. So you're working with, the forestry and also the sawmills and so on. And this is important. So just imagine, I have an order of 10,000 board feet, which comes every 6 months. Sawmills is not interested in me. Okay, I'll do it. Right? Suddenly I say that, you know, I have an order of 16,000 board feet every month. Then the light bulb goes on. They say, aha, you're my customer. Okay? So what you do is that you can say, look, I've got this order, this customer orders coming from this builders. We are in this hot season. We're building like crazy. You know what? Now the roles have changed. Before you ignored me, now I am saying that, you know, I'm willing to work exclusively with you alone. Okay? So if I work exclusively with you alone, what are the advantages? Tell me. Pardon me? Monopoly. Okay. What does monopoly mean in this case? Who is the monopolist? Who is the producer? HLC is the producer. What is it producing? Nothing. No, I don't know if you are understanding this. We are dealing with the mills. HLC trying to build relationship with the mills. How will they be the monopolist? The mill owners cannot afford to be the monopolist. They are dying and going out of business. I mean, they will be lucky if they survive. Yeah, so that is HLC or the mills? Does everybody agree with what she's saying? So it's the exact opposite, you're right. It's HLC. Well, don't use monopolist as the thing. There's no such thing as a monopolist over here. They can easily go to another company like HLC. No, what I'm asking, okay, let me rephrase my question. Let's make sure we understand it, all of you, okay? If HLC says, I will only work with you as my preferred sawmill, what are the benefits to HLC and what are the benefits to sawmills? That's the question.
Benefits of HLC is they'll have good influence with the mill.
Very good word.
They'll get the first priority always for cutting the wood, the FSC wood. And mill will also in turn...
No, there are more benefits. I mean, you did a very good job in the first one, right? What are the benefits are there if I say I will work only with you? Pardon? Locked in effect, okay, all that is fine. What else is there?
Sir, the supply chain will be fixed. Means it will be in a flow that there will be no any other buyer or there will be any breakage.
No, I'm still not hearing. That's a good point, but I'm still not hearing.
Actually, the mills are offering a uniform product, sir. Instead of switching over, the shutdown periods are reduced.
That's also fine, a point, but you're still not getting at the most important thing.
Sir,
well, exclusivity agreement.
As its logo sold easily. As its logo said, what up? As its logo stands for what up, maybe that principle affects, give impression to the buyers.
Okay, well, thank you.
Store stock by the mill will be sold easily.
Okay, all that is fine. You're missing out on the most important thing. Quality is there, I agree with you. You can work closely with that. Like she says, influence, you'll have an influence. When I have a concentrated power, pardon? It's okay, I'll give you a hint, it starts with P. Ah, come on guys, price. No, monopolist, okay, it's an economic term for the structure of an industry. That's why I don't like that term. It's not a monopoly. What did I mean? By the way, you never have the power all the time, okay? Even when it comes to price. What happens is, it goes through a negotiation process. You're going to the mill and you're saying, look, previously you didn't give me that much attention. Utna pyar nahi tha. But now, suddenly, you're going to love me because I'm bringing you business every month, okay? So, because of that, obviously I'm going to expect a lower price from you, okay? Definitely it starts with a price motive and then you start thinking about quality, getting into inventory and rotation schedules, okay? Exclusivity gives the benefits of HLC because they can demand lower price. Now, how do the mills benefit? Pardon? Okay. Okay. Can you, I know a lot of you are not operations people, but can you kind of go in a little more depth? You remember they were saying they were not being efficient, right? So if I get a steady set of orders, there's a chance that I'll be efficient, right? So what's the technical, well, I don't, let me give you the answer. The other thing which they will benefit is capacity utilization, which is very important, okay? So for instance, a mill, and I can give you a very layman's definition of this. A good way to look at a metric is how often is the mill idle, okay? If it is 10% idle, that means it's got a 90% capacity, okay? So it is quite possible it was 10% around the previous case because, you know, HLC and other people were not giving it too much orders. But suddenly we have this bonanza of orders. So now it is not 10%, it is 1%. Or maybe it is, you know, I need to have other excess capacity somewhere else, subcontract it to get this business and so on. Okay? So it benefits in terms of the steady set of orders, which means it fills the capacity, which means its costs go down. And because if its costs go down, now this is a win-win situation because it will say, Mr. HLC, you said you wanted a price break. I will give you a price break because my capacity is very high and I am able to utilize all my equipment. You know, my laborers are all fully occupied rather than idling and sitting and reading newspapers. So they are doing jobs for you, productive work, and everything is win-win, like a nice Hollywood story. Right? Exclusivity. Okay. Now, you remember now, this is the lock-in effect which is happening. Sorry, you were saying something? The disadvantage. Now, what is the disadvantage? I agree with you totally. So, the influence in the lock-in effect is true that just because you're trying to do your muscle power and flex, that could well happen. Now, being HLC, you will proactively try to make sure that doesn't happen. That's also true. I mean, she brings up, but this is the notion of risk. Okay, so the fact that you don't want to put all you're saying this is the risk of exclusivity, right? Very good point. So I agree with you totally, and that is very true. You don't want to put all your eggs in one basket. It creates all these risks and so on, right? Now, remember, I was telling you the win-win situation over here. It's all about negotiations, right? HLC will come and say to the mills man, you're about to close down, so you don't have any, you don't have any clout in this transaction over here, right? I'm actually being your savior and trying to bail you out, okay? So they can take advantage of the fact that half of them are closed down. And imagine this. This is a very important operation strategy question over here. If you are a cookie cutter standardized operation, you're in threat all the time. Because anybody can copy you. So that's why you need to differentiate. You need to find a new niche segment for you to survive. And they didn't do that. And for them, lucky them, HLC is coming like a blessing in disguise and saying, I'm your niche segment. Okay. You don't need to do any operations planning. I'm coming here and giving you your niche segment, right? So HLC, you know, I can give you exclusivity. I am there for you. I'll make sure that you don't close down. And so then they'll be starting to think about partnership. Long term. Then you can do long term contracts, okay? I mean, there are so many. This particular case has got so many conceptual richness in terms of supply chain knowledge. I hope you will remember this. Tell me, what is the advantage of long-term contracts for supply?
Continuity, assured business continuity.
Okay. So if I have a choice, I work with the sawmill and I say, we will have a contract for 6 months as against 3 years. What are the advantages and disadvantages?
When we have a contract with 3 years, like we can have an assured business, we can have, we can plan our material, operations, capacity, efficiency, utilization, everything accordingly. So 3 years is an assured business which HLC is giving to the sawmills, which otherwise was already in a closed down status. So even 1 year, it's itself is a very good business for the mills.
Very good, I agree with you. So with the sawmills, they have a clear advantage, right? How is it advantageous to HLC?
They can demand
this
what they want.
What we discussed
yes.
earlier.
They
yeah.
can demand.
I won't use the word demand. I like her word influence. I gave you a preferred contract for 3 years. I can have an influence on this. If I say build more quality, do certification, okay? I observe hazardous practices in your thing. They're more likely to listen to you. The opposite is also true. If you are only going there for an occasional contract, why will they listen to you? I'm not going to change my processes because of you, because you're a small-time guy for me. You're not a big customer, okay? So they can encourage long-term contracts, including asking the mills to seek certification, the point that I just said, okay? That you can ask them to seek FSC certification as well. Now comes the other jewel, this whole notion of eco-labeling, okay? Before I start that, what are other examples of eco-labeling? That you know, you use this product every day. Energy Star is a good one, right? In IKEA, they have this rug mark, which is supposed to be an eco-label for a carpet made child labor-free. So you see so many examples of these eco-labeling. Okay. So with this FSCSL eco-labeling, does it competitively differentiate HLC from the building market? What do you think? Does it matter? It does. Who will give it value? Who will value it? Which consumer?
Customers.
Which customer?
Builders.
Are there a whole lot of them?
Third party people.
Like, give me an example. That's a good one.
Sir, in FSC, they are having public peoples for active environmentalists.
Social activities. Pardon? Scientists is a good one. Environmental groups, right? They will parade. And this is probably one of the reasons why HLC wants to do this. It wants to be getting that green label over there, okay? Now, this is very, very important. You remember that article which was there, which you got about environmental production, product differentiation? He is the author who came up with this. And isn't it wonderful that when you have who's dealing with a particular conceptual principle, here are the three things to look for. Here are the four things to look for, right? So in this article, what he says is that have an environment if it satisfies these three conditions. The first thing is willingness of the customers to pay usually a premium for environmental quality. Is that clear? Like BMW. Why would anybody buy a BMW? Because it's a zero, 100% recyclability things and all that, right? Some, car purchases valuable. So the first thing is willingness amongst customers to pay a premium for environmental quality. Second thing is the credible information about the environmental attributes of the product. Have you heard about greenwashing? Nobody's heard about greenwashing? Okay. Greenwashing is the term that they use when companies or anybody else claims environmental and sustainability benefits, which is then proved to be wrong. I'll tell you a very interesting example over here. There was this entrepreneurial company, which what they did is that they collected, I think, all the garbage in London town and used some mechanism to convert it into aviation fuel, which is remarkable. I don't know how they did that. Okay, and then sold it to Boeing and Airbus. So this article was widely published and all the garbage in London and converting it to fuel, right? And it turns out, as in most cases, that the amount of energy that it took to convert all that garbage into the aviation fuel did not justify the investment at all. There was no payback at all. So you may think that this is an alternative green way of making it. It was not even economically feasible, not to speak about whether the aviation fuel was tested, what would happen, is there any functional downgrading in performance, all of these things were not done. So in all of these cases, when people make a claim, then scientists or other people will start testing those claims to see if this is a verifiable thing that they see. Is it really not harmful? For example, cotton, organic cotton. We talked about it, right? The process of making organic cotton itself uses a lot of chemicals and water and so on. So you wonder if that label justifies what you're doing, okay? So credible information about environmental attributes. The last thing is innovation must be defensible against the imitation of competitors. So one favorite company of mine is Gillette. It's very hard to imitate their blades and so on. So he says if these three things occur, that the innovation is cannot be copied, if there is credible information that is truly environmentally friendly, and third thing from a customer point of view, they're willing to pay for that. If these three things happen, then the product differentiates on an environmental basis. Okay? All right. So all right, so let's look at FSC. The short answer to the question is that it provides unclear value to the customer. Okay? And largely the certification appeals to the altruistic value of what the builders are holding, and the, not just the builders, any homeowner who thinks that, you know, I care about the forestry. I care about the habitat. That means what happens to the birds and the animals and all that, and the surrounding ecosystem. If that is the case, the certification is supposed to appeal to only those types of segment of the population who say that these things matter. Okay? But unfortunately, in our case, what is happening is the functional characteristics of certified wood and non-certified wood are the same. Okay? So the consumers may pay a premium for the certification because of the altruistic values they have. Nothing to do with the performance of the particular product, right? And they don't think that their product is necessarily a high quality product, so that it justifies the premium. They're paying it because we're doing the bigger, larger good. We think we need to support that. So for example, Starbucks, when they work with fair trade farms, why would I pay an expensive and by the it's labeled excuse me it's labeled these days fair trade coffee. You pay a slightly expensive price, you value the fact that the farmer gets a bigger chunk of the profit for the effort they're doing than what he used to get historically, right? So Starbucks made this intervention to say that the middleman should not make all the profit. We should go back to the grower and give a big portion of that. And they've done that globally. So I think it's a fantastic program that they've done. And many other companies like Nestle have followed and all of that. So consumers are paying a premium for an altruistic value, not for a superior value in quality. So it seems that unless, so for from HLC's point of view, this is a minority community. We are only dealing with environmentally consumers who care about maybe even wealthy consumers, and then now we throw in a very interesting customer base, which is the government. So government goes on public record saying I invest in LEED, I invest in social development, and so these things are important to me. And once they've said that in the public domain, you say, well, if you say that, then why not take some part of our business too? Why can't I be a supplier to you, and I can now kind of apply to those programs, and governments will entertain this. For instance, minority development, a lot of governments have minority development initiatives where they have a certain set of business that they set aside for minorities too. A good example of what at risk over here, because you cannot raise your prices that much to the rest of the customer base. Only to these guys, they're willing to pay, right? So, and the other thing is that so the FSC ramification, the builders had to keep the inventory, and now they're transferring the inventory risk to HLC, right? So you're keeping the the risky certification product in your hands, and you're really kept the inventory of the builder. So that's the risk that we. Now, we are going to come back to lead. We are not done with lead somewhere later on in the course. Compared to FSC, lead has much more wider penetration, more widely accepted. Okay? Being very broad acceptance, and in terms of federal buildings alone, it's true of any country. If you think of the number of federal buildings we have in any city or in any country, that's humongous. Okay? So, and they will have to probably continuously maintain their lead standards. So, a lot of business for them to on an ongoing basis, right? And the good news for HLC is within lead, FSC is the standard. Okay? So, this will increase the demand for FSC and so on. Second issue, credibility of FSC. When it started, it had very good credibility because it was developed by well-known NGOs and so on, right? And it is more credible than its competitor, FSI. FSC, but then FSI is much more lax. FSC is more stringent, okay? And it's the only standard, mind you, it's the only standard that it's full chain of custody certification, a difficult thing to prove over there. So you're dealing with a company with a complex supply chain, and you're hammering it on such very stringent chain of custody certifications, and yet it is surviving. How is it surviving? Okay? This ensures, so this is the chain of custody. Every final product is certified as a FSC if it originates from an FSC certified forest. But the people are not biting. The customers are not biting because they don't understand this. They don't understand the certification process. They don't understand the pains that people take for the accreditation process. It's a very long, long process. And who's paying the price for all of that? We talked about this, right? All the paperwork and all that. Now, imitation thing. You can buy it from the market. It's not the only act in town. Right? So the only thing holding on to HLC is the upstream transaction cost. That you're working with the forestry, you're doing demand pooling, you're doing product pooling. Okay? And there's a very thin demand for FSC, and it seems like the projection that you can at most support two suppliers. Okay? And the transaction cost is fixed. Like all the things we talked about, identifying certified forests, mills, coordinating production schedules, transportation, and monitoring the physical quality of the product. Okay? So, conclusion, and we went through the test of this three-part test for FSC, and we conclude that it's unlikely that FSC certification serves as a source of environmental differentiation for the reasons we have given: limited demand, okay, and the certification appeals to the feel-good factor rather than feeling good about the environment, rather than any other functional characteristics. Okay, there's a credibility question. Some of the Hayward customers are unaware of this, and competitors can also sell FSC. So, taking collectively together, FSC itself is not going to differentiate. So now you see part two of the cinema as to why, when they said this is my one act in town, I only am latching on to FSC, and I'm saying that's not enough to survive, and so it forced HLC to do other things. Okay, and so it seems like today we are having so many new conceptual principles that we are sharing. So it is very logical that they had to resort to horizontal diversification. What is your understanding of horizontal diversification? And let's just stick to HLC. What are they currently doing? They're working with which product? Lumber. Okay? In horizontal, so now you have a choice, right? I am working with lumber. When I say horizontal diversification, what am I doing? Related products. Thank you. This was much quicker than I thought. Very good. Okay? When you take one main product and you find related product, you're doing horizontal diversification. So this looks like this. There we are. So this is HLC. We started with lumber, and then we started doing green building materials like doors and windows. This is horizontal diversification. Okay? So what are the advantages of horizontal diversification?
Main
Pardon? You think there's a supply, there's like a delivery advantage? Okay, I like that. This is like, I think what you're talking about is bundling. You can bundle a small one which will otherwise not sell with your main product, and both of the products will also sell. Okay, that's also true. So from that's also a form of bundling, and you're able to sell more of that, right? So from HLC point, I like this term a lot, lohas. You know what is lohas in Hindi, right? Iron. So a good way to remember, lohas. Okay, so this program, Lifestyle for Health and Sustainability, was another niche segment which said that, okay, I would like to build, I would like to buy green building product materials. So the horizontal differentiation idea is that if I'm otherwise interested in, really interested in all of the green building materials, okay? So the builder, so the same thing is true for, from the energy point of view. A builder who's interested in energy efficient buildings will want to make sure that it's energy efficient throughout, what we call as a building envelope, okay? So the premiums paid for energy efficient windows and doors will be lost if, for example, the walls and ceilings are not similarly insulated, right? So the total system should be green, okay? And it can serve, the other advantage is that, and as you know from the case, they created the design center, that I can have a one-stop center where builders can come and buy everything they want as an integrated package, as you mentioned. Okay? But the disadvantages of that, the simplest way I can example this is that one spoiled apple will spoil the entire bunch, right? It takes only one spoiled apple to spoil the entire one. Thank you, sir. So what is happening over here is that if you market the whole bundle and be it green, and one of them turns out not to be green, then you lost the disadvantage, you lost the advantage of horizontal differentiation, right? The other thing about this is their competitors. The DIY is a huge segment. I think it's coming also in India, where you become the handyman, that you go and build, get your stuff, and then you build it yourself, okay? So Home Depot, Lowe's, you know, all these types of companies are big competitors for them. And then the other problem is that you may go heavy on the green materials and try to promote the low toxicity and non-toxicity, but people may not bite on that, you know, on related products. They may say it really doesn't matter. So for them, even amongst greenness, there's a different shade of what greenness are. And builders tend to rely on tried and proven products rather than new green products. So that's a disadvantage of trying to sell this. Okay. Now we found, we now understand the horizontal diversification. Now let's look at our friendly cousin, vertical expansion. So vertical expansion or vertical integration is like this. And you know now the genesis of why this happened, that their business was threatened. So they had to say, now the only way to grow is now our FSC is not, it's a song they've heard before, they need a new song. And now they said the first new song is going to be horizontal differentiation, the second new song is vertical integration. So what did they do? They said, we're going to invest in the lumber mill. Okay? We're going to start investing in the design center, which is this one-stop shopping services. Moreover, we're also going to provide consulting services, okay, to our customers. And we're going to build a truss plant. We'll see the advantages of that. And we're going to acquire Eco Timber. Okay? What is Eco Timber in the business of? Pardon? Bamboos. Sorry? Bamboos. Where does it go into the building? Flooring. Sustainable flooring. Okay. So we have HLC, which is doing the truss plant, you know, obviously in a very green manner. So we took the top part of the house. Now we need to take the bottom part of the house. Jacob's EcoTuber. Okay, sustainability flooring. Okay. So amongst the options of this, the advantage of owning the thing, the vertical integration, is that now you become your own supplier because mill is yours. You can now have a better control over the quality, and you can make your high quality. See, remember, it's very important about the timing too. If the sawmill makes a poor quality cut, you have no other choice than to make the right quality cut at your lumber yard. Now we have saved that step by saying we'll make the high quality cut earlier, at the earlier stage. Remember, I talked to you about total quality management. So quality at the source. Okay. So this is what's happening. I can control the quality, a high quality cut for my high end customers at the mills itself. The disadvantage is that it costs a lot of money. Even though the guy is dead, almost drowning, it still requires some money, capital, right? And it also is an expertise in a different industry. You don't know the mill industry that well, so you may not, there's a chance that you may fail. Now the purchase price, now's your chance to buy, because you know they're going down. You can go and muscle in and say, hey, I can give me this attractive price because you're going out of business. So that's a pros and cons of with the mill. The other thing you can do is the design center. It's a one-stop shopping shop. And by exhibiting these products, in products, you can increase the demand for like cabinetry, windows, related solution. So providing a one-stop shop for green builders, but the cost is pretty humongous, $2 million. But these people are very optimistic. They're saying they'll break even within the first year. $2 million to erect it, $5.5 million. So I'm going to hold the suspense till the last. So the suspense is, did they really break even? Did they really, was this really profitable amongst the vertical expansion decisions they did? You by now figured out that the horizontal differentiation already took place because they did invest in green materials. But you don't know what happened to these options. In fact, let me stop and ask you this one question. Okay. Amongst 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, amongst these 5, do you think was a success? And which do you think was not a success?
Consulting services.
Which one was?
Consulting services.
Consulting services. What else? Take a guess.
Truss plant.
Pardon?
Truss plant.
Truss plant? Design center also. So you're saying everything was a success. What is left now? Only EcoTimber. EcoTimber is a success? Logically think of it. I just gave you a hint. So you think it will be a success? Okay. It makes logical sense, right? And from the house point of view, it makes sense. A ceiling is taken care of, you know, purely. So what could go wrong in that equation, right? It makes logical sense for the acquisition. Am I right? Okay. We talked about, now let's get to the consulting. Design center, we talked about it. Consulting service. So now, with trusts and all that, what they're trying to do is that they are trying to build a modular product which comes in so that it is not a disintegrated module, in the sense that you're not trying to take different parts and then trying to build it at the site. I'm going to deliver a modular product at the site. So truss is a modular product. Okay. So this advanced framing which goes into the truss is something that HLC will build and bring to the customer. Okay. And then they can advise them on green materials, energy efficiency, cost benefit, which is a very important thing. Just because you're going green doesn't mean that you win on all the fronts. So there's a cost and benefit analysis, right? And the sad part of this, I mean, not sad, but of course no builder will pay for this because they're saying, well, it's the cost of doing business for you. Why should we pay, right? So they say they cannot charge this, but at least I can stimulate demand. I can say, well, you talked about this. I can make this building a little bit more greener by thinking about these options, right? And they can demonstrate integrated solutions, right? Where sure enough, I mean, this is a, probably a very crucial thing in the minds of the builder, that green materials are going to be expensive. So you try to think about the long-term operational savings, right? Life cycle costing. Long-term operational service, saying that on the long term, you will save on energy, you may save on carbon footprint and a lot of things, effectiveness. Okay? Truss plant. So, is that you prefabricate a lot of things like the roof, the panels, and so on, and so that you reduce the wood requirement at the site. Okay? And I told you this advantage as well when we talked about point of sale. Trusses have to be ordered 60 days in advance. So that you have that opportunity after that to cross sell other products, because they already lock you in with the truss order. Where will they go? So then you say, well, can you, you know, buy cabinets, doors and all that. So this early, we talked about this, is early demand information reduces the impact of long supply lead time, and reducing total wood requirements through advanced framing is important because the lumber itself has a 20% premium cost. Okay? So this is the easiest thing. They should have thought of this very long ago. So I can buy Eco Timber, which is already proven to be the sustainable flooring choice partner, and that's a much mature market than sustainable labor. And the sales tend to be specification driven. Okay, so they're all specification driven. That means you think about the flooring at a very early stage in the design process, and your customers are quite different. Your customers are not the installers of the flooring, but they are the architects or the design engineers or the construction people. Okay, so you're working with them rather than the installer. Obviously they have to do it much earlier in the life cycle. And this is also important. We talked about cross-selling of products, right? Now you see the similarity. We have horizontal differentiation, vertical differentiation. We have cross-selling of products, but we can also have cross-selling of customers. When I acquire Eco Timbers, all your friends become my friends. That's the simplest way of explaining this. You have a database of, oh, by the way, all your enemies also become my enemies too. So that's the downside of that. All your worst customers also you inherit. Okay? So you have a database of clients who also are interested in other green building products. Okay. The last conceptual thing which you need to know, which is the synergy between environment strategy and business strategy. Okay? So the way they have demonstrated the synergy between what is happening in the environmental level and what's happening at the corporate level is that we have seen examples of this. First is horizontal and vertical expansion. Okay? And the second thing is, okay, so this is in the context where a lot of volatility going on over there. It's a very much of a pain to work in this value chain and so on. So they had no other choice. I think we talked about this. They had no other choice than to say we need to move away from FSC, continue with FSC, but look at new things, right? So they brought in the product portfolios, vertical integration, working with the forestry, downstream vertical integration, working with the green building customers. And so all these three options, product, vertical, and horizontal, together demonstrate a synergy between what is happening at the environmental strategy level and the corporate strategy level. Okay, now you're probably waiting for the climax of what happened. So this is the climax of what happened. There was a new act in town. The new act in town was arson, and it hammered FSC down. Look at the hammering. 98% of all lumber sales was arsenic-free lumber. Only 2% was FSC. HLC did end up building the truss plant design center and did purchase Eco Timber. Truss plant turned out to be the least profitable. I'm sorry, truss plant, sorry to disappoint you. And as we expected, Eco Timber was the most profitable. Okay? Consumers were more likely, see, here's the odd thing, it's a logical thing. They're saying, okay, standing on a floor, and I know it is FSC certified, it came from Green Forest, I feel a lot comfortable. The hidden truss in the ceiling, why do I care? I don't. Association for bragging rights. So the customers were more likely to pay for the into the flooring rather than, okay, the first year of operations they generated $6 million, which is not bad, but less than 25% gross margins. But this came from truss, but almost nothing from the wall panels. Okay, the wall panels, by the way, developed quality issues. They started to fail, and fewer of the builders were willing to experiment in some of the new ones. And then they had this modular fitting problems. When they solved the problems, they found that they didn't fit very well with the floor network. Okay, so there were reworks and delays and so on. To give them credit, the roof truss is the most complex thing. Okay, and the very challenging part of the house, and the wall panel was the easiest one to do. Okay, so, and you can do, even though they can do all the CNC tools for the truss, compared to the wall panels, the use of technology over there, it still did not make, did not work very well. Now, there's a very interesting contractual aside which happened. They were getting this truss bids, right? They were getting this truss bids earlier on, 60 days earlier on, right? HLC in his very naive, very friendly, I want to be a good supplier to you. What they did is they shared the design prototypes with the truss. And so with the roof truss, with the coat, they say, well, here's the design. Here's the advanced framing. This is what it's going to look like. What is the coat? You know what they did? The customers took that nice little design, a nice little coat, and went to the competitor. And they said, you build it for us. We did all this hard work only to benefit a competitor truss plant. So, and then you're doing a lot of upfront engineering work, you know, without any chance of even earning any money over here. So what they needed, as some of you did point out, is an effective information system to support price quotation before fully engineering the job. And what will this information system do? It will collect historical information. What was the data on tasks, job requirements, what is the quoted price, you know, and what was the production cost. So building that will kind of mitigate the chance that you'll have a loss. All right, we're now down to the summary of the case. It's been a fantastic case because it was so rich in so many principles, okay? First of all, like many other cases, it gives you an inside view of the lumber industry and the building industry, okay? And we get to know a point we're going to come back later on in the course, the role of certification. So we use an example of FSC as a role of certification, and to make matters complex, there are many other standards that firms can pursue. So firms will have to make a choice as to which they will pursue, and HLC did make a choice of FSC, and look what happened in the update. A new certification came into place, arsenic-free lumber. All right, we saw the ripple effect of building high-margin building products that you can also cross-sell building materials. We saw expansion opportunities, the vertical ones. Truss plant didn't do too well, struggling. Design center worked very well, and acquisition of EcoTimber is a good investment. Okay, the lessons learned is this case gives you an excellent example of it gives you an excellent example of product efficiency. It gives you an excellent example of demand pooling efficiency. And finally, it gives you an excellent example of how companies need to align their environmental strategy with corporate strategy. Okay, I end my case. So is there any comments, feedback, questions remaining in there? So in the first two cases, I did the lessons learned for you. I would like you to build a practice starting from, I think we're meeting on Friday, we're looking at Herman Miller. I want you to start thinking,
sir,
about
how this lumber area will get impact in the Indian market.
Yeah, I'll get to the point in a minute. When you discuss Herman Miller on Friday, I would like you all to prepare some notes in bullet point on lessons learned. And we will do the same thing when you go on the board and do that. Okay? I want you to dig through it. What is the conceptual thing and how does this lead to the lessons learned? In context, what do you think? What is your comment on that? How does this relate in the Indian context?
If we need to cut the tree, we need to get the permission from Green Tribunal Authority. So that is a big problem for us in India. And that's what I am asking.
No, attempt to answer the question you're posing. you know the supply chain. This supply chain is not going to be any different in India, right? So tell me what is happening in the first box in India. First is getting less. Deforestation. Anything happening in the mills?
Sir, mills improper. When they are sawing all the woods, there will be adulteration process. This happening, I had seen lively. What they will do is they will just replace the another wood, which customers as well as some of the less experienced engineers they can't find those things, which is the actual one, which is the fake one. This is happening in mills, and also this one transportation problem. Many damages is occurring.
There's in route damages.
Yeah.
Too.
Transportation damage.
This question is pretty good, and I would like all of you to kind of reflect on it. Gives you a general principle of learning. When you learn a case, and the cases are largely in the Western context, you should always ask, well, how is this adapted to the Indian context? And the answer is not just one cookie cutter thing. You don't expect a professor to give you one answer there. The answer is for you to discover that. So what you should do is, if you were to answer the same question which he's asking, I want to do a lot of research on what is happening currently in the forestry industry. Data driven. Read the articles. What are the publications and go on? We all know it's deforestation is going on. But get a better sense of it. Are there any positive news? Pardon? Social forestry. Okay. Like greenhouses and all that. The farmers grow their own trees. See, this is the sort of example I'm talking about. When you get in depth into a topic, right, you ask a global question, which is a good thing to ask because that's a starting point. You know, so if you say, how does this thing relate to India? I want you to discover that. In each box. So you know what happened in Hayward. So you can ask and compare and to see, are the sawmills very similar between California and what you see over here? There's a distribution. I mean, he brought a good point about even when you have your logs, which is not that much of an issue in the US, you'll have logs falling off. You know, you're taking it on, you know, in the mountainous region or when there's rain, it's quite possible that they fall off, and then there are delays. You know, you have to reload it, maybe get another truck to load it back and all that, you know, and that can happen in any country. But I want you to kind of discover and piece, like a jigsaw puzzle, piece all of these things together from a supply chain point of view and from a sustainability point of view and so on. Asking global questions is good, but I want you to discover it. What is happening to the building industry? Are there an equivalent of in India of customers who want a green building, build a green home? Okay, how will you get that information? Digging. That is what the library research process is, a crucial part of what you folks will be doing in this class. When you do the report for me, I would like to see evidence of where you went, primary data, secondary data, which internet resources that you saw, how to compile a good report. That's where, and then ending up with the key lessons. That I feel, I mean, I've been teaching in the Indian context for such a long time, that's the weakest link over there of library research. And today there's no excuse. The internet is there. You can't say, you know, my library does not have this. You can get it. Right? Your access to information is much more than what used to exist when I was growing up in India. So there's no excuse. Ask interesting questions, but prepare to answer that first yourself. And the way to do that is to accumulate a lot of research. Don't come up with a blanket question, blanket answer also, saying that, okay, this is bad. I said, why is it bad? So you have to ask, like in this class, probing questions. How do you support your view through data, to research and so on? Very good questions. Anything else? But I think you should, for all the cases in this class, you should think about the Indian context. Okay? And you may piece together in the break, somebody is asking like what would be an exemplar company in India who is very good in solar. I said, find it out and let me know. And tell me why. Read a white paper and tell me, maybe you want case study where you saw a successful solar implementation. That's enough, and that's how you build your knowledge about different case studies. And then you take these case studies and then say, what's the general pattern over here? What are the successful companies doing? Fair enough? Okay. All right. We'll break and then we'll go on to the hour. So tomorrow, yeah, we'll break. So tomorrow is Herman Miller. Okay? Remember, that question is coming up. Lessons learned. All of you prepare. Especially the people who are silent today, please get involved. Okay? All right. I'll see you tomorrow.